to Rapstorian, where we analyze hip-hop and urban pop culture. We then break them down into reference videos for your information. Any alterations to any media are to prevent copyright problems, and all art is owned by its respective companies. Like other genres of music, hip-hop is a competitive art form. Rap artists are unique amongst musicians because they're expected to compete for the unofficial title of the King of Rap. This is such a serious charge that hip-hop culture created a mechanism, the rap battle, as an effort to offer an objective solution to a subjective debate. There are many important battles in hip-hop history, but few as historic and as impactful as the Jay-Z Nas or Ether battle. Never before had the presumptive number one and number two in rap ever gone head-to-head at the height of their powers. Never were two battle participants more diametrically opposed. Jay-Z was the mogul. He represented the commercial power of rap, and Nas was the prophet, representing the power of its poetry. This was a battle for the very soul of rap, and the legacy of this battle still lives on to this day. In fact, the word ether itself has now become a verb, meaning to utterly destroy a foe. And now, Rapstorian will take a comprehensive look at the ether timeline and everything on wax that led to its inception.
Presidents to represent me. I'm out for presidents to represent me.
The seeds of this epic battle were planted in 1996. With Jay-Z's song, Dead Presidents, in which he sampled Nas' voice from The World Is Yours. This is notable for two reasons. One, because it's the first time that Jay-Z showed Nas love on wax. And two, Nas was also invited to the video shoot for Dead Presidents, to take part in the video's famous Monopoly game played with real money, but he didn't show. Recall at this time that Nas really didn't see Jay as a contemporary of his. He considered himself in the class of a Biggie Smalls. This would be the first time Jay-Z would throw unreciprocated love in Nas's direction, but it wouldn't be the last. More proof that Nas was more Biggie-focused was the fact that in July of 96, he began sending subliminal shots to the newly crowned King of New York. Nas felt compelled to take aim at Biggie's coronation with these bars from The Message.
For one ring, it let me let y'all niggas know one thing. It's one life, one love, so there can only be one king.
That was the contours of the rap game at that time. Nas's beef was simmering with Notorious B.I.G., and Jay-Z was on the outside looking in, until one of the most tragic events in hip-hop history shuffled the whole deck.
Early this morning in Los Angeles, the 24-year-old rapper, whose real name is Christopher Wallace, lived in Raleigh in the 1980s.
FBI agents are looking for a man they say could...
Both communities are mourning the death of the rapper known as Notorious B.I.G. Good evening, everyone. I'm Linda Laverne. Miriam is off tonight.
He was only 24 years old, was just starting what was expected to be a promising career in music. But tonight, it's only what could have been.
On March 9th, Biggie Smalls, the King of New York, was gunned down at the age of 24. The death of Notorious B.I.G. sent shockwaves through the rap game and had a profound effect on the subsequent directions of both Nas and Jay-Z. Jay-Z made it his mission to continue Big's legacy as the new King of New York. Nas, on the other hand, looked inward. He was deeply affected by B.I.G.'s death, considering their standing at the time, and over the years expressed his beliefs musically. Though Biggie was murdered just weeks before the prophetically entitled Life After Death album dropped, the album was recorded months beforehand and addressed Nas' beef with him directly on the Kick in the Door record when he said,
"Your reign on the top was short like leprechauns as I crush so-called Willie's thugs and Rapadon. Get in that ass quick fast like Ramadan. It's that rap phenomenon, Don Dada. Ain't no other kings in this rap thing. They siblings, nothing but my children. One shot, they disappearing. It's ill when MCs used to be on cruddy shit. Took home, ready to die. Listen, study shit. Now they on some money shit. Successful out the blue. They lightweight. Fragile. My 9 milli make the white shake. That's why my money never funny. And you still recouping. Stupid, stupid."
He also addressed Nas on Puff Daddy's 1997 album, No Way Out, with this line on the Victory record. Bear in mind that Nas's daughter is named Destiny.
"The sun is, they say my killing's too blatant. You hesitating, I'm in your mama crib waiting. Duct taping, your fam, Destiny lays in my hands. Gat lays in my waist."
Biggie's death effectively put an end to the subliminal war of words with Nas. However, it would be just a few months later that Jay-Z's rhymes would begin to grab Nas's attention. By the time Jay-Z released In My Lifetime Volume 1 in 1997, he was ready to proclaim himself the King of New York, but he still wanted Nas' friendship. On the blatantly titled The City Is Mine, he spit,
I'm the focal point like Biggie in his prime on the Lodo.
And then on Where I'm From, Jay-Z cleverly puts himself in Nas and Biggie's category with
I fought with niggas pulling your car and knock you all day about who's the best in team, Biggie, Jay-Z, and Nas.
And finally, Jay-Z shows Nas even more love on Wax by once again sampling a classic line on the record Rap Game Crack Game. Ultimately, this will be the third time Jay-Z shown respect for Nas on Wax with nothing in return. Nas' silence was beginning to speak loudly, but the Queensbridge rapper wouldn't be silent for much longer. The bootleg of Nas' third LP, I Am, features a track entitled One Love, Part 2, We Will Survive, in which Nas raps to the former King of New York saying,
and these niggas is wrong, using your name in vain, and they claim to be New York's king, it ain't about that.
This is the first time Nas mentions Jay-Z on Wax, and he goes right for the throat. Nas essentially calls out Jay-Z for fraudulently paying homage to Biggie and rejecting the claim that Jay sat in the vacated throne. This is effectively the first salvo of the impending war. Jay-Z's irritation simmered for months until he absolutely unloaded on Memphis Bleek's record, What You Think of That, in August 1999, in which on his verse, Jay-Z mocked Nas's rhyme structure on his Nas's-like record.
Niggas ain't crying like I'm a clown or something. Like I don't get down or something. Like I don't talk a 4 pound or something. Round here front like my shit don't sound like nothing. Like I ain't got the crown or something. Like I ain't the nigga you base your life on. I guess I ain't the reason you got that ice on. Like
by this point, Jay-Z, the biggest star in rap, had finally grown tired of Nas refusing to show him his due respect. He also resented Nas's implication that he was falsely honoring his friend's memory for personal gain. It didn't take long for a response. Just months later, Nas references the hook of Memphis Bleek's What You Think of That on his record Nostradamus when he retorted,
I need an encore, y'all. You should welcome me back. You want a ball till you fall? I can help you with that. You want beef? I can let a slug melt in your hat.
And then, on Bleek's Is That Your Chick record, things escalated even further. Nas's baby mama publicly stated that the record was a subliminal shot at Nas concerning her sexual relationship with Jay-Z at the time. Now considering this relationship, it's worth noting Jay-Z's verse when he spit.
Yeah, don't get mad at me. I don't love him, I fuck him. I don't chase him, I duck him. I replace him with another one. You had to see, she keep calling me and big. And my name is Jay-Z, she was all of my dick. Gradually, I'm taking over your bitch. Coming over your shit. Got my feet up on your sofas, man.
Mentioning Nas's daughter's mother must have incensed him, because in the summer of 2000, he went on a warpath. On DJ Clue's The Great One Part 2 mixtape, he released a string of viciousness rarely seen from the Queens native. On the I-49 freestyle, Nas spit this venom.
You can't be I, see I'm eternal, not luck. You get shot up, boxed up next for the grave. Your flow is one dimensional, your level is second grade. You on top, what? Copy and fuck, I said it first, you repeat it. Your false crown covered in dirt, defeated. Y'all niggas all hell, the king is dead. He running like a bitch with his tail between his legs. Still mad, still eye for eye. Wanna be God, you just the next rapper to die. Fucking with Nas.
And by the time Nas released the QB's finest collab effort, his rage still hadn't subsided. On its lead single, The Bridge 2001, he spit this.
Yes,
yo,
millennial.
No faces, fofo blazes, no one safe. This music mogul rolling with 100 soldiers, gangsters we postal. Oh, you didn't wanna know whose life was written. The life I'm living, the ice, the women, the kites descending to life is bidden. The streets, the prison, I touch you, then buck you. Heats be spitting, laser, AR-15, doors come down. Jaws is broke, your whole crew's coughing down. Your hoe, your man, lieutenant, your boss get found.
In a clear sign of escalation, this verse also marks the first time Nas took aim at not only Jay-Z, but the entire Rockefeller Records camp. Nas called out the whole Rockefeller crew, and in one of the most legendary freestyle ciphers ever recorded on live radio, the whole Rockefeller crew responded. On Hot 97 in January 01, the Rockefeller crew repeatedly told Funkmaster Flex to throw on beats from Queens artists, and then proceeded to rip them to shreds over and over again. With Jay-Z playing the hype man in the background, the brazen disrespect even caught the attention of other Queensbridge rappers, such as Prodigy of Mobb Deep. This is when the battle line started to fall along city lines, like it was BK Philly versus QB, and helped set the stage for Jay-Z's real move at Summer Jam. At Summer Jam, After eviscerating Prodigy by putting a picture of him as a kid in dance class on the big screen, Jay-Z removed all ambiguity and subliminal messages. He declared himself to be the king of rap, told the world to ask Nas he ain't wanted with Hov, and then left on a helicopter with Michael Jackson. As a result, Nas was backed into a corner and forced to respond publicly, which is precisely what Jay-Z wanted. At this point, the whole world knew about the Nas versus Jay-Z battle, even if no one knew why. Nas quickly regrouped from Summer Jam with his bars on 01's Paid in Full Stillmatic freestyle when he spit.
With me rip the freeway, shoot through Memphis with money bags, stop in Philly, order cheesesteaks and eat beans fast, and bring it back up top, remove the fake king of New York, you show off, I count off when you sample my voice, I rule you, before you used to rap like the Fooshnickens, Nas designed your blueprint, who you kidding, is he H to the Izzo, M to the Izzo, push Izzo, you phony, the rapper version of Cisco, and that's for certain you clone me, your whack clothesline, I'd rather Sean John bore me with your fake coke rhymes, and no times that never took place, you liar, Un was your first court case, you had no prize.
But even this played right into Jay-Z's hands. His response to Stillmatic was the takeover record on his 01 album, The Blueprint, and it was nothing short of devastating. Jay unloaded on Nas with a flurry of haymakers that would have finished the career off of 99% of the rappers out there.
I know you miss the Nas, but along with celebrity comes about 70 shots to your frame, nigga, you are. Use the fag model for car, can I Esco ass? Went from nasty Nas to Esco's trash. Had a spark when you started, but now you're just garbage. Fell from top 10 to not mention at all. To your bodyguards, Uzi Wally's verse better than yours.
With this one verse, Nas was effectively left for dead, and most rappers would have been. But luckily, Nas is not most rappers. Jay-Z scored points by highlighting his business sense and attacking Nas' street credibility. These weren't friendly jabs. They were potentially career enders. Nas was up against the most commercially successful rapper of the day in the prime of his career. To make matters worse, little known by most, Jay-Z is a seasoned battler. He had acquitted himself well in legendary battles with the likes of DMX and LL Cool J over the years. Finally, by threatening to put his relationship with Nas's baby mama on the table, Jay-Z laid another trap for Nas. It was a warning. The worst was yet to come if he even thought about responding. The stakes couldn't be any higher for Nas. After Takeover, everyone doubted if Nas could even respond. And Nas knew Jay-Z would make good on his threat to expose his relationship with his baby mama, even if he did. If he was to win it all, he'd have to strike back with a definitive battle. He'd have to destroy the whole thing in one blow. He'd have to win it with just one record. And that record was called Ether.
All I did was give you a style for you to run with, smiling in my face, glad to break bread with the guard, wearing jazz chains, no text, no cash, no cars, no jail bars, jigger, no pies, no case, just Hawaiian shirts, hanging with Little Chase, you a fan, a phone.
Absolutely enraged by Ether, Jay-Z released Super Ugly. By no means a subpar response, but it was largely defined by Jay-Z's graphic account of his tryst with Nas's baby mama, and subsequently didn't hit as hard. Jay seemed outside of himself when he spit bars such as...
Me and the boy AI got more in common than just ballin' and rhyming. Get it? More in common. I came in your belly back seat, skeeted in your cheek, left condoms on your baby seat.
Afterward, Hot 97 famously conducted a poll pitting Ether against Super Ugly, and Nas was declared the winner. Perhaps more damaging than losing the Hot 97 poll, or the backlash Jay-Z received for going after civilians, was his loss of composure. Super Ugly presented a Jay-Z most fans had never seen before. He wasn't his typical even-handed self. He was clear that he had lost. Now, the two have since buried the hatchet and worked together. They've moved on, but hip-hop hasn't. The battle's still talked about to this day. Personally, I think this fascination centers around Jay-Z, because I feel that when one looks at Jay, one sees a man who has beat every arena he's ever entered into life. But when it came to the greatest battle in hip-hop history, the favorite faltered. He couldn't outclass the underdog. Jay-Z couldn't beat Nas. And an upset is always more interesting to the masses.